don't you roam this town till that night takes.
I met a man named Gale Dean Wardlow, who is one of America's preeminent blues historians. And he took me out to his house, and he has this cottage out back with a couple easy chairs, a record player, and just walls of 78 records. And he put them on and be like, such a vibe.
Yeah.
And people say to me, I can't listen to those old records. They sound terrible. I said, no, you just got to stop for a second and look at them like an old film. Like, look at what's going on there.
Yeah.
Real people in this really strange medium
yeah.
that doesn't sound like a CD.
He's been a hit maker for four decades. Now, Max Carl of 38 Special and Grand Funk Railroad discusses his quest to explore the roots of American music. Coming up next on Music Makers.
Music Makers is made possible in part by NAMM, the National Association of Music Merchants. We envision a world in which the joy and many benefits of making music are a precious element of daily living for everyone. Wanna play?
Veteran rocker Max Carl has been writing, singing, and performing with the likes of 38 Special, Elton John, Rod Stewart, Bonnie Raitt, Bette Midler, Dan Fogelberg, and Kenny Loggins for four decades. Currently, he tours and performs as the lead singer with Grand Funk Railroad. But he's also a musicologist, exploring the roots of American music and sharing that knowledge with others. Like so many, Max's interest in music began with his family.
What was going on in your family that created a music life for you?
Here's the wonderful thing about my family. My family came to America probably in my grandmother was 12 years old in 1900, so her parents were here before then. And so as far as I can tell, I'm like fourth generation Nebraskan American.
Nebraska, okay, cool.
And everybody, there was Schmitz, my last name is Gronenthal, but nobody can say that. Max Carl Gronenthal. Actually, it's Maximilian Carl Gronenthal.
Yeah.
Thanks, Mom and Dad. So everybody in the middle of farming world, of course, they're mostly German. My mother's name was Schumacher,
right.
And her mother's name was Hanover and Schmidt, all these Germans.
Okay.
I have a great uncle who will be 100 August 8th, and I'm going to get to his birthday party and play accordion with him.
Oh, fun!
And he was talking to me last June. I saw him. He was talking about the Schmidt Family Orchestra. And I was like, that's what they called it, you know?
Yeah.
And they would play in barns. Because there was nothing else to do.
It's probably how you determine what instrument you played, is whatever they need to fill in the group,
you
right?
You just move around, yeah. Of course. You know, that's
hey,
why we all...
We have a new one. You're the drummer.
Yeah, right. Can you play accordion? No, well, neither can anyone else. Here, just do it. You know, push and pull. Hold this note down.
Yeah, right.
The very first picture, funny you would say, you know, all that stuff, but the very first picture is my dad playing accordion, my uncle playing drums, and me playing. I had a great Fender Jaguar guitar. I wish I still had that guitar. And with goofy, you know, black rim sunglasses.
How old were you?
Probably 13.
Oh, great.
In a tractor shed. There's a tractor behind us, you know, playing at some wedding. You know, I think I was like in eighth or ninth grade.
That's terrific.
But the thing was, my father was a world traveler, and he would go to Cuba all the time and bring back all these awesome records, you know.
Nice.
And my mom would play the piano, my dad would play accordion, and my sister and I would dance around the living room listening to Cuban music in Platte Center, Nebraska, 442 people, like 1953 or 4.
Wow.
And so I really,
rhythmically, there's nothing hipper than all these old Cuban things,
well,
you know?
Those things were awesome. Of course, I'm in the mainstream then, Xavier Cugat, you know, and then eventually, pretty quickly after that, the Lucy and Desi show.
Sure.
Right? I'm home, Lucy, and he was with I'm down at the club, you know.
Yeah, right.
Great band. It's like, I want that job.
Yeah, it'd be a good gig to work on. No
so
doubt.
It started with my family. Everybody in my family played.
So
some
it was. There was music happening around
constantly,
you.
Yeah.
So now bring us up toward, you know, obviously, I think one of the things most people that don't know more about the music industry or not insiders in some way would, I'm sure, know you for one of your calling cards with 38 Special. So tell us the story leading up to that.
Well, I had this band called Jack Mack and the Heart Attack, and we were the big splash fun band in L.A. We played just about some of the most amazing parties. We played the coming out party for the Macintosh, for instance.
Oh, wow.
You know, it was just like a computer company. Sure, we'll go. What's it called? The Macintosh. And this is Steve Jobs. Hey, Steve, how you doing?
Yeah.
Was that, you know?
Yeah.
And then who's doing the front? Robin Williams. Well, of course, we all knew who Robin Williams was. Like, Robin Williams, great.
Oh, how exciting.
So we played a ton of those kind of parties and ran through all that. That
was just studio musicians and a
bunch
band.
Of great musicians.
Oh, it's probably just rock.
Just a fabulous. If you go to jackmack.com, there's a live album we made called At the Club Lingerie, and that album was awesome. So that thing kind of ran its course. I went to Germany and made a record. I had a number one song in Germany and a number one video in Canada. Always kind of like, okay, that'll pay for this and that'll pay for that.
Yeah.
I get to stay home and hang out with my kids.
That's
you know.
Sweet.
And then I sort of ran my course, you know, like a player does in a sport. It's like,
yeah.
No, we're not really interested, thanks. Tell Max hi.
Oops.
Ooh, dear. And I got a call. And it was from this wonderful guy named Bobby Brooks. He called and said, do you know 38 Specialists? Yeah, you know, caught up in you, I know those tunes. And, well, would you like to? Yeah, let me go meet those guys. And at the time, my sort of avocation of amateur musicologists was starting to come together.
Okay.
And I thought, if I'm gonna have, went down there and met those guys. I realized I could live in St. Augustine, the oldest city
sure.
in America.
I'm hip to that.
1565, you know, here comes the guitar. They like that's what they brought to America,
okay.
A guitar. You like this?
All right.
I dig it.
So friend of a friend type of call says you need to meet these guys in 38 Special. You go to St. Augustine.
So I get down there and you know, Donnie Van Zandt, that whole family is great, but Donnie Van Zandt is like, he's got a smile like this keyboard. It's just the greatest. So that was a great match. And although I was like this R&B singer and they were definitely a Southern rock band, you know.
Right.
But I played keyboards and sang. And I had written a bunch of songs and got asked into a song with Jeff Carlisi and Cal Curtis. And it was kind of like the last thing we did on the record. We spent about 3 days on it. And was like, God, it's, I remember Danny Carl, maybe it was Jeff Carlisi saying, when you walk in the room, this song is like a breath of fresh air, you know.
And it was the last tune going on the album.
Yeah, and we mixed it in one day, you know.
Yeah.
And it was a song called Second Chance. Yeah. And we put out another song, a song that Donnie and I wrote, and it stiffed. It was like, oh no, this isn't so good. And we got a call from somebody in Tucson who said, you know, we put on that song Second Chance and the phones light up. The best thing that ever happened to me was that song. It really was.
You must be proud, seriously. As someone who's never been close to that level, it always just makes me think, oh man, I would think I died and went to heaven.
Well, it's a wonderful thing, you know.
It sticks with you.
Yeah, and yeah. I play it, and it's just instantly, oh, you're that guy. Although once in a while, I'll play it, and somebody come up to me and go, you know, you did that guy's song really well.
That
I'm that guy.
You kind of look like that guy at Second Chance.
I'm that guy.
It's me. Really. That's great. So 38 Special goes on for a while, but not a long time. What, 3-4 years, something like that?
Those guys, we just traveled too much, and I was not used to that. Yeah. And I had this feeling like I could do something again by myself, which happened pretty quickly. But in that time period, I started meeting different people in the South, and I met a man named Gale Dean Wardlow, who is one of America's preeminent blues historians. He wrote the kind of definitive book on Charlie Patton. That's as far back as you can go. That's pre-Robert Johnson.
Okay.
And he's from Meridian, Mississippi, great guy. And he took me out to his house. And he has this cottage out back with a couple easy chairs, a record player, and just walls of 78 records. And he put them on and be like, such a vibe.
Yeah.
And people say to me, I can't listen to those old records. They sound terrible. I said, no, you just got to stop for a second and look at them like an old film. Like, look at what's going on there.
Yeah.
Real people in this really strange medium
yeah.
that doesn't sound like a CD.
And he's a historian.
Yeah, big time historian. Yeah.
And you get to be buddies with him.
He wants to write songs, and I want to be a writer, so we had this symbiosis.
Okay.
I got the better part of the deal. We never wrote a song. We tried. Sorry, Gail Dean. We'll do it again. But he's a wonderful guy. But he's, you know, would call me and goes, hey, you know, something going on over in the Delta. So I'd drive down from Atlanta, pick him up, and we'd go up into the Delta. And, you know, he took me to the place, Highway 49 and Highway 61, you know, the crossroads.
Okay. I don't, but I do now.
Well, Robert Johnson died in his spot.
Oh, okay.
Right, you know, this is a hellhound on my trail. That whole myth of what happened to him he actually died in this place, which is kind of this funky little lot between a couple of gas stations, the most nondescript kind of place. Get out over here, walk out here, walk out in this place, and it's like, they think you died about right here. It's kind of chilling when you start doing that, you know?
Wow.
So I went to a lot of those places. into the Blues Museum, the Delta Blues Museum, and around the corner from there is a radio station, a man named Early Wright, and I remember going down there and hanging out all night with those guys and him playing songs. And so many great records came out of that era that were the beginning of rock and roll.
Right.
And across the river is Helena, Arkansas, and that's really where a lot of that stuff, remember the King Biscuit Flour Hour?
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, there was a real company there called the King Biscuit Flour Company.
And that's where that happened.
And these guys would play blues in Clarksdale, and then they'd go across the river. Those days, they had a ferry, and they'd go up to like 6 in the morning and play live on the radio for all the farmhands getting up, play blues. So
wow.
There was this record, there was this, you know, that was a small Chicago. You know, people like Sam Chess started realizing, if you guys come up to, you know, when these guys go up to Chicago, there's a whole group of people who want to buy these records here. This is a market. So that fed the talent.
So, and now let's get into, I'm kind of a segue into this interesting thing that you spent some serious time, you kind of discovered this very unknown or little known.
Well, I discovered it.
Like style you would, like, of music, if you would.
I discovered it like you'd walk into a library and go, what's this book, right? And the guys who wrote the book discovered it, right? Mostly song collectors, John and Alan Lomax. And do you know about those guys?
I don't.
It was a dad and son.
Okay.
And the oldest, the dad bought a big cylinder recorder, and he, I think, was a dentist or a doctor in West Texas, and he would come over into Arkansas and Mississippi and record these people.
Just go to the live spot and sitting
on the porch. Which was dangerous in those days, because if you were a white person coming on a plantation to record people who worked for that plantation, you know, in the 20s and 30s, you'd get thrown in jail. Those guys got thrown in jail periodically.
Wow.
And down in this spot, in the hill country, in a little place called Gravel Springs in Colmo County, Tate County, Mississippi, was this wonderful little wildflower of American folk music called Mississippi Fife and Drum.
Fife and drum, and okay, as in fife
as
and
in
drums.
Fife, you know, and they made, this was made by Otha Turner, who has an exhibit here, or working on an exhibit here, just a piece of bamboo, and where the strengthening joints are. He would take, I don't know if you remember, but old pickups used to have these pins that you put in that you put the gate up and pin these things down that were L-shaped, and he had one of those, and he would get it hot, and he would drop it down in and break this point, and cut it where this would be a natural stop. They call this technically a transversal flute because you blow across it, not down, right? And then I asked him, how do you know where to make these holes? He said, well, I just kind of put my hands on there and figure out how to do that.
Just kind of figured out.
Right, and this one's kind of beat up. I'm sorry to say that.
But oh, that's okay.
He made it. I can't give it up. And play blues to it, you know.
Wow.
With all these.
Well, I want to.
Jim and John had a race. Jim beat John to the same old place.
So you are finding out, so you got fife and drum, Mississippi fife and drum, huh? And that is the coolest sounding. And it is, it's just literally fife as in fife and drum.
Yes.
So they're doing it with blues, though.
Yeah, of course.
And tell me about the drumming aspect.
Well, it's pretty straight sounding, I got to be honest with you. Depending on who's doing it, there's a handful of different families that do it a little differently. But Otha Turner, who passed away in 93 at 94 years old, his family played.
So kind of marching band stuff
straight ahead.
And which, again, would stick with fife and drum. That's where this all, you know, think of the Revolutionary
but,
Band.
You know, right? It was like, well, that's where it all got started. I had a point in my life where I thought, there's got to be a place where the first Native American, African American, and European American played music together.
Maybe that.
So I started, you can write the Library of Congress and they'll send you a catalog. And so I saw this, there was Otha's picture on the cover.
Wow.
And a big cotton wagon.
So they're playing snare drums.
I'm sorry
to interrupt, but yeah, I'm still getting this. And then singing on top of it. Okay.
You know?
Wow.
But here's the thing. I mean, that is probably, it's still a really esoteric little, like I say, a wildflower in the field of American popular music, folk music. But it's so close to what started happening in New Orleans. Louisiana and Appalachia are really the two, the mother and the father, if you will, or the pollinator and the tree that gets pollinated, that made all American music. Because American music is really completely world music. Sure. I mean, you think about Louisiana, the Spanish came and they kind of drifted, and the French came and they claimed all the land, including Nebraska, by the way. Some people, I grew up in Louisiana. I sure did. I just came kind of late.
That's right, that's right.
The French came, and while the French were there, Germans came in and had this spot up on the river they called the German Coast. And if it wouldn't have been for the Germans, I always thought the French, right, the Acadians who came in, was
right.
Cajun. I thought they brought accordions with them, but I've only recently read that the accordion was brought by the Germans and introduced to the French, and that was how accordion got into Cajun and Zydeco music.
Interesting.
So you got Spanish and French and Germans, and of course lots of English,
right.
And Africans and Caribbeans, and people from Haiti. When the slave revolution happened in Haiti, a lot of people came through there.
And stir up that pot.
And Canadians, who also, the Cajuns, that's a sad story in our history. Below the St. Lawrence River in Quebec and Nova Scotia and down all the way to Maine, New Brunswick. When the French came there, they intermarried with Algonquin-speaking Native Americans.
Okay.
And the French-Indian War, I think it was the name of that war. Anyhow, the French didn't want them in because they were friendly and intermarried with Native Americans. So that was a horrible time.
Wow.
But there were only about 10,000 of those people, anyhow, 11,000. So many of them died getting kicked out of there.
Max, these are just fascinating stories.
America, you know?
Yeah, it is, and it's it's gotten to be a something that you just dig, and you've just gotten better.
Yeah,
and better,
it's like when you start learning piano, right?
So, yeah.
It's like how many tunes can you learn on a piano?
Yeah.
How many great piano players can you discover until the day you die?
Yeah, right.
And there'll still be a trail out the door. That's just one instrument.
So how did this then? And now I'm really doing another segue. Tell you, we're moving forward now. You've got this new project where you're doing this one man. I don't want to call it a one man band. What do you actually call the presentation?
I call it a one-man show.
Yeah, one-man show. Okay, that's a one-man band.
That's cool. I play a hi-hat and a harmonica and a guitar all at once.
You've got chops enough to play, you know, a lot of these instruments that you're sitting around. But you know, in this one-man show, you'll come out and play a hi-hat, be playing piano, drums, obviously play the fife, all those things, huh?
Yeah, I play. But I also have, you know, it's technological too. This is another part of what's always happened to music is technology, right? So, for instance, the piano didn't come around till 1700s or something like that.
Right.
Italian. Bartolomeo Cristofori.
Cristofori.
Right. And then, because I guess Liszt was tearing all the pianos apart, you know, getting stronger and stronger.
Different things with with escape and
right,
all that
right.
stuff.
Right. So technology has always been with musicians. And I use a digital tape. Is basically like a tape machine. It's made by Boss. It's called RC300. I love it. You can record as many overdubs as you want on three different tracks.
Oh, so like a looper.
So sometimes it's a looper. I'll start a tune by myself and play this, and then get up and play on the piano
while
it's doing that. Get back over there and pick up another instrument and keep. You know, it's another parlor trick.
Well, that's great, though.
It's not that easy to do.
No,
it's not
like you just took the word. I was going to say you might call it a parlor trick. I call it some musical skill.
I'm not in any big rush to get through this. I'm writing this book, and it's like I'm building boats. So it's like I started building this boat, and it was the book, and then I started building this show, and pretty soon the show's floating, and it's like, well.
What's the book about, Max?
The book is all these stories.
So we've been talking about all this interesting stuff. I want to, and you've got this show now, you say your one-man show. I want to hear, you brought some instruments. Give me just a little ear candy on some of the stuff you're playing.
I'd love to.
Yeah.
As we were talking about, and you're aware of, this area north of the French Quarter that was called Congo Square, then it was turned into called Louis Armstrong Park, which is what it's called.
Down in New Orleans.
Yes. Yeah. And in that, that was one of the few places in America where Africans, slaves, could get together and play music and have a cultural day every Sunday. And this drum is called a djembe. It's a chalice-shaped drum. It's an African drum, and the word djembe is from the Mali, and it means let us gather together in peace.
Oh, I didn't know that. Right? Yeah, it's spelled DJ, D-J-E-M-B-E,
yeah,
right?
Yes, yeah, the djembe, yeah. Right? And because it's like that, those were the first drum circles, and in Congo Square, people went crazy because these people would get together and play anything they could and dance and sing and play and sell stuff.
Giant drum circle.
And it was like, wow, let's go to Congo Square, it's Sunday, right? Those kind of drums, you know, like when you walk up on a drum circle in a park.
And it's thundering.
It's an incredible thing.
Thundering, yeah.
Yeah. Well, that is strictly an African thing that brought, without that, the groove, without the groove,
yeah,
right?
Doesn't happen.
Which the Spanish called claves, which means the key, right? Like all Afro-Cuban music is really part Spain and part African. And when you read these, the elder gentlemen of African pop music and they talk about Cuban rhythms, they take a little umbrage of that. They're like, oh, wait a minute, you know. we brought that over there.
Right. Let's get this straight, yeah.
Right, and so without the Congo Square and what happened there and a certain amount of largesse by the Napoleonic code, if you will, American music would not be
what it is today.
What it is.
So, like, in addition to that, obviously you play some guitar in the show, right?
I do. I'm a guitar owner.
That's kind of like me and piano.
Well, you know, as I told you earlier, my father came home with all these great Cuban records back in the day. And my whole family became attached to kind of everything Cuban, you know. And so when the Mariel boat lift happened, if you recall that.
Sad days.
I recall just seeing pictures in the paper. And that was kind of about the time that CNN was broadcasting, right? So all those pictures of those people rowing in makeshift boats from Havana to Miami. And I sat down in my little house in Studio City and wrote this tune. And it has taken on a life of its own. Bette Midler was a fan of my band, Jack Madden Heart Attack, and she loved the song when I played it for her. She recorded it. It's on her greatest hits.
Sounds nice.
Yeah,
feather in your cap.
God bless you, Bette.
Yeah.
Gloria Estefan says, the best song ever written about Miami. I was like, oh, come on.
Let's hear a little bit.
And I sat down, wrote this tune with a little bit of duende, right? Walking along the beach last night, who you think do I spy? Girl with ebony fire eyes, soft and low do she cry. What could be such a source of pain? I so boldly inquire, pointing finger heaven. These are words which transpired. She told me only in Miami is Cuba so far away. Only in Miami the stories she go this way. Standing on the shoreline waiting, everyone anticipating, I can hear the broken hearted say, only in Miami is Cuba so far away.
Mm-hmm. Nice. Boy, and hip rhythmic thing too, like you said.
Gypsy King stuff,
I guess. Appropriate, but appropriate to the tune and all. Yeah. That's beautiful.
Well, Latin music is a huge part of America's oeuvre.
Yeah, cool. Now, I'd love to see. I see you brought your accordion.
I did.
Let's see that demo.
This I had to stand up and get. It weighs about 40 pounds.
Yeah, being a piano player, there's nothing that intrigues me more than.
Listen, this thing is it's a really extremely difficult instrument.
Oh.
I've only been playing about 10 years, and this particular instrument, a concerto made by my good friend Paul Pasquale from Salt Lake. Well, it's a fabulous instrument. You know, Louisiana music still honors the waltz, which
sure.
you would be just hard pressed to find the last time you heard a waltz on the radio.
Don't the years roll past like wheels down a hill?
The sunshine, the moon, and the shadows. And you ask if I love you. Well, that I do still. From the past through today and all tomorrows, as our lives sail by under sacred sky. Like a New Year's Eve waltz with you.
Yeah, thanks, Max. That's great. I appreciate you doing it without any mics or anything. That's a big gift from a guy who's used to much better surroundings. So.
Well, this room sounds so fabulous just by itself.
Hey, your voice sounds great too, obviously.
Oh, thanks.
It is a gift. It is a gift. Listen, thanks so much for sharing this with us. This has just been a hoot.
Thanks so much.
Music Makers is made possible in part by NAMM, the National Association of Music Merchants. We envision a world in which the joy and many benefits of making music are a precious element of daily living for everyone. Want to play?
For more information on Music Makers with Scott Houston and program guests, please visit our website at www.musicmakerstvshow.com.